This back in 1963, back when your mom and daddy were just courting, right?
Just courting.
Let me hear you sing it. Oh, the joy.
blinded star, mirror of the Father's glory, lies beside him in the strong. He is mercy's incarnation, marvel at this miracle. For the virgin gently holds him, glorious impossible.
When you walk through the storm, hold your head up high and
Hello, everyone. We praise our God. God is so good, right? Amen. Before we begin, I would love to share a verse with you all before we come into a time of worship. And it's in Psalms 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors all your ways so that sinners will turn back to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, you who are my God, my Savior, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. Open my lips, Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. You, God, will not despise. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, Father, we thank you, Lord, for the privilege, O Lord God, Lord, to be able to worship your holy name, O Lord, and to usher your people, O God, into worship. Father, may your Holy Spirit be with us tonight, Lord, from every part, from the beginning until the end. Lord, may your Holy Spirit reign. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. Sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Name of Jesus, name of Jesus.
Death could not hold you, the veil torn before you. Silence the bones of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names.
You have no,
you have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you.
Come on.
Yours is a kingdom. Yours is a glory. Yours is the name above all names.
You have no.
You have no right.
Lord Jesus, yours is the only name, O Lord God. There's no other name but the name of Jesus that can set people free. There's no other name like the name of Jesus. No one compares to who you are, Lord God. Father, we just give you glory and praise, O Lord Jesus, because you are so worthy. And for what you have done for us in the good and the bad, Father, you are so worthy to be praised. Father, may we lift your name up higher and higher, O Lord God. Father, we love you, Lord Jesus. Love you, God. Thank you, Lord.
To the one on the throne, Jesus, Lamb of God, hands and feet pierced for all. He wore the crown of thorns to the one on the throne. Jesus.
Power. Yeah.
us, O God. Lord Jesus, we will love you, O Lord. Father, we see you on that cross, O Lord Jesus. To the one on the throne, O Lord God, you are calling after us, O Lord Jesus. Father, we are reminded of what you did for us on that cross and from everything that you've done from here on out, O God, and from war in the past. Lord, you are the same God yesterday, today, and forevermore. We have power, O God, in your name, Jesus. There's power in your blood. Lord, every nation shall be set free, O Lord God. Every single nation, O Lord Jesus, from the bondage that has captivated your people for so long, Father, they will be set free in the name of Jesus Christ. And Lord our God, all the praise, glory, and honor goes to you alone. For you alone are Yeshua, you are Jesus, you are our King, O Lord God, you are our God. And Father, there's no one like you. And Father, we give you glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. God is good, amen. Thank you once again, everyone, for taking the time to plug in for our weekly Bible study. And I will be sharing tonight, and before I start, I would just love to bring us into a time of prayer, and that His Holy Spirit will be with us tonight, and as I speak and as I share, that His Holy Spirit will cover me and everything else, Lord. Father, Lord Jesus, we thank you, O Lord God, for the privilege, O Lord Jesus, to be able to share your message, O Lord God, and encouragement, O Lord God, and a challenge, O Lord Jesus, to your people. Father God, as I share, O Lord, may it be from you, O Lord God, the words that I say, O Lord God, and the scriptures that I give to your body. Father, may your people be blessed, O Lord, and may your people be challenged, O Lord God, and to be reminded of your goodness and your mercy, O Lord God, that you have for your people. So, Lord, may your Holy Spirit be here with us. Cover me with your precious blood, O Lord God. And may, wherever your people are watching, standing, sitting, wherever they are, may you be with them right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God is good all the time. So, hello, everyone. My name is Elijah Tamambo, and I'm 23 years old. I just turned 23 on October 14th, and I can say that throughout these past few years, God has been so good throughout all these years. And even though there were so much mishaps and problems, and maybe some of you have shared in my story and know about it, but I just want to give all the glory to God, because if it wasn't for Him today, I would not be here. So God is so good. So before I start, I would love to share some verses with you. And the first one is 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 to 11. And if you are currently home, or if you listen to this through audio cast, I encourage you to bring out your Bible or maybe your Bible app and follow along with me, okay? So it's 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 to 11. I want you guys to listen intently so that the Word of God can penetrate through. And we know that the Word of God is like a double-edged sword. It pierces through bone and marrow, the most hardest of metals. And we know that through the Word, we are able to learn more of God's heart, to be challenged, and more so to be strengthened by what is being said. So in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 to 11, it says in NIV, "Be alert and sober-minded. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To be him the power forever and ever. Amen." Isn't that amazing? God is so good. And reading this verse, we have to understand that we are in constant warfare with the enemy. And who is this enemy? Satan. If you guys can recall, there's a Bible verse that says that we are not against flesh and blood, but we're against evil spirits, demonic principalities of this world. So when we look around us and we see all these problems going on around the world, talking about racism, talking about terrorism, you know, all these bad things, we have to understand that there is a bigger problem behind it all. It can have many different titles, but the problem is sin. And with sin, it entices the people who go through it all. So keep in mind, just as a reminder, that the devil is prowling around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And in verse 9, it says, resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. I remember last month in the summertime, I was going around sharing the gospel with my missions organization, and I was able to minister it to a lot of people, you know, from the young ones to the old. And it's really interesting because as I went out and I shared the gospel, personally, I believe that many people would accept it and more so be changed by it. But in all honesty and truth, when I went and I shared this gospel to the people here within America, from California to Arizona to New Mexico to Nevada, I realized that people hate God and they do not want anything to do with him. And it just goes to show that where we're going to right now. And looking at all of that, I thought, because I went to a missions trip last year in wintertime to the Middle East, and I was sharing the gospel there, and reluctantly, a lot of people are so open to hearing about who Jesus is, the true, authentic who Jesus Christ. And people were really accepting, even though we got a lot of rejections as well, I will tell you that. But more people there were more open. But here, it's so difficult to share the gospel, but it still needs to be done. Amen. So as I was sharing and going around to these different states, I met up with an atheist, and his name is Robert, and he's from Nevada. And I met up with him at Las Vegas while we were going throughout the Strip area and we were preaching the gospel. I was sharing the gospel with him, and after like a few bickering back and forth, a few arguments and all that stuff, he told me, Elijah, you would make a fantastic atheist. In fact, you would be so good. And then I looked at him at the time and I was like, How in the world could I become an atheist after I've witnessed all the goodness of God throughout all the years of my life? And so I thought, right? So after I came back, many of you guys know our family story. A lot of us, the majority of us got sick. Praise God that my sister did not get sick. I think she's immune or something like that, but praise God. But everyone in my family got sick, my brother, myself, my uncle, my mom, and my dad. And throughout that time, it was so challenging because I went around sharing the gospel. I met up with so many people throughout these different states, and I come back home, and everyone starts getting sick. So I started thinking to myself, what in the world, did I do this? Did I spread this virus amongst my family? And, you know, all these, like, questions started filling my mind, and then we all got sick, and then my dad and my uncle got put into the hospital. And when he got into the hospital, I began to become so scared out of my mind, and I was blaming myself. Initially, that's how it started, because I thought I was the one who brought it to the family. And throughout that period, as my uncle and my dad were fighting for their lives in the hospital, I was praying before God, like earnestly seeking him, like crying every single night, like, God, please, please do not allow them to go like this. Please heal them. Do your work. Father, do what you've done before in the past. You've healed so many people that I've known, my family. You've done it before, so do it again. And I was yearning, and I was crying out to God for that. And obviously, as you know, my dad got much better. He healed up sooner than my uncle did. But and we got news that my uncle was going to get better. But 3 days after we got that, he passes away. And it was during this time when I was really seeking God, and I began to seek only his goodness throughout that time. And you can see how bad that is, to only seek the goodness of God. And when that happened, when I heard that news that night, I was so full of anger. And I was so full of bitterness. And I had so much skeptical questions that would lead me to question this God whom I served for the past 10 years. Because I accepted Christ when I was 13 years old. And with that, I began to ask the most hardest of questions. And it seemed that no one could answer it. And the interesting was that instead of turning to God or turning to friends and family for my healing, I turned to myself. And obviously that was not such a great thing to do as I've learned it. But praise God, because he used that time to grow me. But as I continue the story, after my uncle passed away, I had all these questions. And on that night, on September 1st, I became an atheist. I began to ask the most, like a really big question that a lot of atheists today now ask. If a caring and loving God is here today, why is there so much evil in the world? If God is so real, then blah, 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 this and that. I had so much things like this that has crept up into my mind. And throughout the past year, I've been able to learn so much about theism, pantheism, Buddhism, atheism, Christianity, Islam, so much different types of religions. And, you know, all these things just came on pounding at me at that moment. And my faith was so shaken, and I became an atheist for a week. And throughout that time, my body began to deteriorate. I did not desire to eat. I did not desire to do any sort of physical activity. I desired to die. And in addition to that as well, yes, I had a lot of people praying for us, but not many people reached out to me personally, reached out. And it was so frightening to me because it's a body of Christ, but where was the body, you know? So I really felt so alone during that time. And throughout that whole period, I just began to grow more and more in my unbelief and my skepticism and began to denounce the faith as a whole. So when every time my parents would try to pray or like pray for the food and like, you know, talk about his goodness, I would scoff like, really, is that true? But I wouldn't say it because I still respected my family and my parents and all that. But I remember on September 6th, the day before I came back to Christ, I heard a verse from Job chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. And this is what I heard very clearly. And this is the verse that actually struck through my heart and pierced through my mind, which made me wake up. And I will read it for you. If you still have your Bibles, please open up your Bible to Job chapter 2, verse 1 to 10. Story about Job. On another day, the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them to present himself before him. And the Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil, and he still maintains his integrity, though you incited me against him to ruin him without any reason." "Skin for skin," Satan replied, "a man will give all he has for his own life. But now stretch out your hand and strike his flesh and bones, and he will surely curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, then, he is in your hands, but you must spare his life." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and afflicted Job with painful sores from the soles of his feet to the crown of his head. Then Job took a broken pottery and scraped himself with it as he sat among the ashes. His wife said to him, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." He replied, "You are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" In all this, Job did not sin in what he said. Amen. I'll read it again. He replied, "You are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" So when I heard that on the radio, my heart started opening up more. And I was like, wow. Here I was this whole entire time just seeking the goodness of God. And I forgot that, what if this is his will? What if? But still, I refused to repent before God. Still, I refused to give my heart back to him. And then a day after that, actually in this room right now in our garage, there are three ways for, you know, Christians to share heart and burden with other people. And number one is to bring that to the Lord, you know, bring it to prayer. But I didn't believe in God at the time. I hated God. Secondly, I did not want to, the second way to cope with that is bring it to your brothers and your sisters. Well, I mean, my brothers and sisters were not there for me during that time. Thankfully, some were, but the ones who I deemed that were so close were not there. And you can really see and figure out who's close to you during those times when you go through hardship. And third, another way is to express yourself or expression. And I did that. You know, in this very room, I wrestled with God and I exerted so much energy towards Him. And throughout that whole entire time of just going back and forth with the Holy Spirit and the Lord, after a couple of hours, He brought me to my knees and I repented before God. I repented and I said, I was sorry, God, for blaming you. I'm sorry, God, for bringing this here, because I still believe that I was the product, who's the reason why that all this sickness came. God, please forgive me. God, please forgive me for destroying my body. God, forgive me for this hatred, oh God. God, forgive me. And I wept and I wept and I fell down before the Lord and He slew me in the spirit. And I'm here today. And God is so good. No one else can do that. Imagine that. You would wonder why, wow, this man was a Christian for so long. How could he turn into an atheist? Maybe you have friends like that. But coming to this conclusion, we understand that these things have to happen, right? If we go back to 1 Peter, it says, be alert and sober-minded. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And here, and the God of all grace who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will Himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To be Him the power forever and ever. Amen. So some of you right now may be struggling with this kind of thing right here. Maybe you're part of the church board. Maybe you're part of the worship team. Maybe you're leading a Bible study group and you have your question that's led you to question and question and question. And there's no problem with questioning. It actually leads us closer to God. But understand this, is that after you have suffered a little while through sickness or through pain or through emotional pain or trauma, He Himself will restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. Amen. So when we acknowledge that, is that these things that we are going through after you have suffered, God is going to restore you. God is going to make you stronger, firm, and steadfast. And to Him be the power. Only God has the power to do that. Only the power of Jesus Christ has the power to do that. Nothing else. And in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 to 9, after I repented before God and I brought all my shortcomings to Him, oh man, there was still so much problems, so much more things I had to deal with, because the devil did not want me to get out of that. He still wanted to keep on feeding those lies to me. He even used people who were close to me to destroy me, but still, praise God. Because He's so good, and I have nothing against that anymore for what the people have done to me. But because God is so good, you know, He's using these things. And Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 to 9, it says, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. Our God is alive. Our God is so good. And there's no other religion out there, only the Judeo-Christian worldview that gives grace so free as a gift. Where all the other religions of this world, all the other beliefs, you have to work hard to get your salvation. You got to do this and that, a set of rules to follow. But truth is, we're human. And that's why we need grace. And that's why our God is so powerful. So if God can change my life, if God can convert this once an atheist back to Christian, back to the lover of God, what can He do for you? So much. All you got to do is just have faith and believe and trust in God. So the things that I learned throughout the season is that time is so precious. Time is so precious. It's so valuable. And also that too, the body of Christ is so valuable. You have friends and peers who are right next to you, maybe just a phone call or text away, and they're willing to help you as long as you're willing to open yourself up. God knows I'm a peeled back onion now in me sharing all my burdens with all my friends and those who I trust. And I'm so excited for what God is going to do. And when I look back at what God has done for me and what he's done for my family, and I look back at what happened with my uncle, I can say that he's so faithful. And although my uncle did pass away, it was very heart-wrenching on all of us and our family, and even you, church as well. You guys prayed for us, and we're so thankful. And for coming for me, I'm so thankful for you guys. How much more are the people who do not have the knowledge of Jesus Christ? I'm so thankful that my uncle knew God. He knew Jesus Christ, and he brought his sins before the Lord. He repented, and he began to live for him. And I'm so thankful. That put so much peace in my heart. But when I look around us and I see the things that are going on around the world, this is why we need to share the gospel, because they have no hope. They have no faith. And church, only when we begin to realize the importance of sharing the gospel that saved us, we will never truly grow. And even more so too, you have coworkers, you have friends, you have schoolmates, old classmates from before in the past who do not know Christ. Reach out to them. I encourage you. I encourage you, because every single day they are dying without the knowledge of the gospel, and they're going straight to hell. Because what does the Bible say? What does the Bible say? If you call on the name of Jesus, you shall be saved. There's no other name out there. So at this time right now, I would like to read this verse to you, and then we'll come into a time of prayer. Psalms 13. And when I read this, I want you guys to apply it to yourselves. Maybe you guys are in this first section where I'm talking about, or maybe you're at the second part where you're feeling you're feeling free. But I want you guys to listen and take it to heart. Oh Lord, how long will you forget me? Forever? How long will you look the other way? How long must I struggle with anguish in my soul, with sorrow in my heart every day? How long will my enemy have the upper hand? Turn and answer me, O Lord my God. Restore the sparkle to my eyes, or I will die. Don't let my enemies gloat, saying, "We have defeated him." Don't let them rejoice at my downfall. But I trust in your unfailing love. I will rejoice because you have rescued me. I will sing to the Lord because he is good to me. Amen. God will use your circumstances in order for you to grow and to be shaped for the harder times ahead of you. And you need to be equipped. You need to be ready for the things that are going to be happening. So at this time, let us just pray. And I'll first start with our beloved church, Holy Ground Family Fellowship. Lord Jesus, Lord God, Father, Lord, we thank you for this time, oh Lord Jesus, that we would be able to gather as your body. Lord, to be able to gather in one heart, in one mind, and in one spirit. Father God, we acknowledge that you are sovereign. We acknowledge you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And Father God, may you be the King of this church. Be the King of Holy Ground. And Father, may you guide us, O Lord Jesus. Guide the leadership, O Lord God, from the pastoral staff, O Lord God. Pastor Gunder, Tita Mercy, Pastor Ryan and Marisol Lictas, O Lord God. Eric and Marilee Tamambo, O Lord Jesus. Pastor, O Lord God. Father, you know them by name. And Father, may your Holy Spirit guide them every step of the way, Lord, as we progress, O Lord Jesus, throughout this year. And Father, O Lord God, we pray for the deacons, O Lord God. Lord, that you will guide them in every single decision-making, O Lord God, that they will be filled with your Holy Spirit. O Lord God, they will propel us in a direction, O God, as they give advice, Lord, as they lay their lives down, O Lord God, for the sheep. O Lord God, Father, may you sustain them, O Lord Jesus. And Father, may you let them be an example to all of us. And Father God, I just want to pray right now for our body of Holy Ground Family Fellowship, oh God, from the kids, oh God, to the youth and to the oldest and the youngest, oh Lord God. Father, we acknowledge that you are King. Father, may you be Lord over our lives, oh Lord God. Father, may we not just be waiting for Sunday to God to read the word. May we not just wait until Sunday or a Bible study to get right with you. May we not just wait until those times, oh God, to start opening up your word. But Father, may you put a hunger in our hearts, oh Lord God, to yearn more after you, oh Lord Jesus, these last days. Father, oh Lord God, I lift up the kids and the young people to you right now. Lord, Father God, we're coming to a state of lawlessness. Oh Lord God, everywhere we look, there's sin, oh Lord Jesus, and it's fighting for our young people. Father God, may you strengthen our young people today with your conviction, with your power, with your love. And Father, may they be ready and equipped, oh Lord Jesus, to defend the faith, oh Lord God, when they're pressed and questioned, oh Lord God. Lord Jesus, may you demolish, oh Lord God, Father, all streams of pornography, oh God, within the hearts of your young people tonight. Destroy it in the name of Jesus. And Father, oh Lord God, Father, may you, oh Lord Jesus, destroy, oh God, these prideful thoughts within the young people. Oh Lord God, Father, without you, we are nothing. Oh Lord Jesus, Father, all the great and big, gigantic degrees of this world, oh Lord God, is meaningless if we do not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. So Lord God, Father, may you move mightily within our young people right now, oh Lord God. Lord, that they would be like Daniel, oh Lord Jesus, refusing to eat the king's meat, refusing to bow, oh Lord God, to the big statue, oh Lord God, that Father, your people will be ready, oh Lord Jesus. And Father, we pray, oh God, for the adults, oh Lord Jesus, every single mother and father, single parent, oh Lord Jesus, that is watching this. Father God, may you strengthen them with the word, oh Lord God. Father, may you enable them, oh Lord God, to effectively share and bring your gospel, Lord, to the family, bring it to the home, oh Lord God, not just relying on Sunday school, relying on Sunday, but Father, it's every single day. Oh Lord Jesus, that we have to cultivate and grow our young people, Lord Jesus, to grow more in you. And Father, may you make them a wonderful, a great example, oh Lord God. Father, we're not perfect, oh Lord Jesus. Father, we make mistakes, but Father God, you are so gracious and kind, oh Lord God, that you are still the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, oh God, I pray for all of the people right now who are sick, who are battling with any sort of diseases, with any sort of flu, with coronavirus, with any sort of that matter. Father, oh God, you are the King of Kings, and you are the Lord of Lords. And Father, every time, oh Lord Jesus, we proclaim your name, the devil runs and flees. So Lord Jesus, may you touch every single young soul, every adult, oh Lord God, that Lord, you will touch them mightily from the inside out and make them new right now, oh Lord God. And Father, may your goodness and your mercy, oh Lord Jesus, bring them to renewal today, oh Lord God, as it said in your word, oh Lord God, that after suffering for a little while, our God will renew them and restore them, oh Lord. Lord Jesus, we just pray right now, oh Lord God, for our school system, oh Lord God, from preschool to elementary to middle school to high school and college, Father, from every single degree. Father, Lord Jesus, we know that every single day that the school system is pushing out God. They don't want to be teaching about Jesus Christ in the schools. Father God, I pray, oh Lord Jesus, that you would enable our kids, oh Lord God, and our young people to take a stand for you. Oh Lord God, these last days to take a stand, oh Lord Jesus, to uphold the righteous values that you've given to us, oh Lord God. And Father, oh Lord Jesus, we just pray, Lord, that you move mightily, oh Lord God, within the leadership, oh God, within every single school, oh Lord God, here within Fresno and Clovis and everywhere else, oh Lord God. And Lord Jesus, we just pray, oh Lord, for our government right now, oh God. Lord, we pray for this year's election. Father God, may we be drawn, oh Lord God, to seek after you, oh Lord God. Father, to seek after your will, oh Lord God, and who to vote for. And Father God, may we, oh Lord Jesus, have a sound mind, oh Lord God, that Father, we would bring our vote to the one who will bring and breed Christian soil to be grown within this land for these next 4 years. So Father God, may your Holy Spirit, you touch us and bring enlightenment to us, oh Lord God, as we seek after you. And Lord Jesus, just as I have suffered, oh Lord God, Father, maybe there are some Christians who are listening right now, Father, who have unbelief, Father, who have questions and doubts. Father God, we know, oh Lord Jesus, that you are the one who knows it all. You are the one who knows what's going on behind the scenes. And Father God, I pray that you would be with them right now, oh Lord Jesus, that you would comfort them in their times of loneliness, in their times of unbelief, that you, oh Lord God, will be able to comfort them, oh Lord Jesus, and that you would send people your way, their way, oh Lord God, that they would find salvation in your name, and Lord, that they will be brought back to you, oh Lord God. And Father, may you strengthen them as you did for me, oh Lord God, that would be to be more firm in the faith, oh Lord God, to defend the faith, and ultimately to live, oh Lord God, as a living sacrifice before your throne. So Lord Jesus, oh Lord God, Father, we pray for every single unbeliever within our city, within Fresno and Clovis. Father God, we are moving to a time, oh Lord God, where Christ is being brought out. Oh Lord Jesus, there's revival happening all across the world. And Father God, may we partake in it. May we not just be bystanders, oh Lord God, just watching on the sidelines. But Father, may you put us there, oh Lord Jesus, not because we're good, not because we know how to speak well, but Father, because we love you. And because we love you, we do these things for you, oh Lord Jesus, to save the lost, for that is your heartbeat, oh Lord God, to seek after the lost, oh Lord Jesus, for all the 99 that you have left to come after the one. And Lord Jesus, Father God, we thank you, Lord, for what you have done for us, Lord, as a church for the past 18 years. Oh Lord God, you have been so merciful and so kind. Oh Lord Jesus, Father, I pray, Lord, that with every single soul, oh Lord Jesus, that is watching this, oh Lord, Father, may you touch them right now, oh Lord God. Father, may you touch them right now, Lord Jesus. Father, you know their struggles. You know their shortcomings, oh Lord God. And Father, may they be reminded that they are not alone. They have you. You have never left us nor forsaken us, oh Lord God. Lord Jesus, may you move in a mighty way tonight, Lord, that you would move in our hearts, to convict our hearts, and to grow more to seek after you, oh Lord Jesus, to be true, authentic lovers of the Lord Jesus Christ. So Father, we thank you. May you bless your people tonight. May you move in a mighty way. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. Our God is good. Amen. Thank you guys so much for taking the time to plug in tonight and to join us on our weekly prayer meeting. And before you go, once again, I will read this verse for you. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. God bless you, everyone. Have a wonderful weekend, and we will see you on Sunday. God bless you, everybody. Bye-bye.